Good evening. Welcome to the auditorium. Please keep your hands and arms inside the carpet at all times. Tonight, we bring you a frolic through the field of knowledge entitled Algorithm. We begin our tale here in the Forest of Delusion.
Greetings, fellow Earth humans. Good morning, starshine. The Earth says hello. What a time to be an inhabitant of this beautiful planet. Now, I definitely am from this planet. We come from France. But if I wasn't, boy, would I be confused. Let's say, totally hypothetically, of course, that I was actually 400 years old. My goodness, the change I've seen. Or would I have seen had I been alive, which I wasn't. Long gone are the halcyon days of yore, when a simple peasant could work free from the 9-to-5 schedule and without the pressure of a daily work quota. Your pastoral splendor and simple pleasures are what drew us to your planet. We came in peace. Now we've become so controlled by our environment.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. Hold up. Are you actually suggesting that peasants weren't beholden to a schedule like, say, the sun? I mean, sure, they didn't have to submit a TPS report each day, but instead of worrying about their quarterly reports, they were worried about things like their crops getting ravaged by locusts or the plague. Okay, my bad. Do you think this is harder? I mean, I'm filming this at 2:00 in the morning, and you're literally just wandering through the forest.
I mean, there are a lot of mosquitoes.
It's not even a job. We're not getting paid. This is just a hobby. That's right, folks. This is going to be a YouTube video about YouTube. But I bet you already figured that out from the title, because you're a smarty pants. When COVID hit, a lot of people's lives were turned upside down. Maybe you got laid off. Maybe you had to work from home. Maybe all of a sudden you were homeschooling for the first time. Maybe you found yourself working 80 plus hours a week because you're an essential worker. But if you were a YouTuber, your life didn't change that much. Now, I'm not trying to downplay what happened to anyone or nag on your faves. And this entire video is about how YouTubers were negatively affected. So stay with me. I know that many YouTubers found themselves with no movies to review, no way to make community-based content, maybe even no restaurants to mukbang. But the majority of YouTubers, at least the ones that I'm familiar with, they are familiar with how to record from their home, they have a robust digital life, and they're even well-equipped to do digital interviews. This is why we saw late-night hosts referring to those YouTubers to try and get advice of how to record out of their homes for the first times. Which, good thing they did, because those first few months were rough. And yes, I have heard reports that revenue went way down after the pandemic. Now, I don't have any actual numbers because I'm not a big enough channel to be monetized. But I have seen videos where bigger YouTubers talk about it, and the absolute hell that it can be to try and navigate community standards without turning yourself into an absolute caricature. That being said, there was a large influx of new people spending more time on YouTube than they ever had before. And most channels saw their viewership getting a bump, with people having not much else to do but sit at home and watch videos. All of a sudden, the normies were finding out just how much content was available off of cable. And getting a bump in viewership gets YouTubers excited about hitting their next milestone, so they invest more time and energy into, you know, retaining that new audience and engaging with them. And herein lies the problem. In order to be successful on YouTube, you need to appease the algorithm. The term algorithm comes from the Latinized version of the name
Muhammad ibn Musa al-Khwarizmi,
who's a Persian polymath who's often regarded as the father of algebra.
Al-Khwarizmi.
Algorithm. I guess I can kind of see it. Anyways, just a friendly reminder that Western civilization is a completely arbitrary term, and the Middle East is so much more than their conflicts.
You have a specific set of instructions to follow in a specific order, and if you do not follow the instructions and the order, you will end up with completely different results. Ah, and let's not forget about la rapport. In English, you say, I think, ratio.
Ratio being the quantitative relation between two amounts, showing the number of times one value contains or is contained in the other. The word was borrowed into English in the 1500s and originally referred to the faculty of reason, and then later to reason itself. But in the 1600s, ratio was taken from the realm of rhetoric and applied to a mathematical concept. It was a direct borrowing from the Latin word kilos ratio, which also happens to be ratio.
Getting ratioed. Nasty business. Just imagine being loved and revered by the people, and then all of a sudden everybody turns on you because of some slight misunderstanding and a smear campaign. C'est tragique. Just as a creator dreads being ratioed, so too does our cake. If you're trying to make a specific dish, it's very important to try and follow the recipe and not make substitutions and not do deviate from the ratios.
Now, the traditional English pound cake has a ratio of 1:1:1:1. It's sturdy, it's no nonsense, it's delicious, and it's England. If you go messing about with the ratios, you could end up with anything from cookies to, heaven forbid, crepes.
But that being said, if there's no bread for the peasants, I say let them eat cake. That's wonderful.
So keeping with that analogy, the YouTube algorithm. It's like a baker who's baking cakes, but he is baking like a million cakes every second for every viewer diner on the platform. You, as the viewer, take a bite out of the cake. If you like the cake, then you'll keep eating it. So the baker will keep making cakes that taste the same because he wants you to keep eating. With each cake, he's going to try and tweak the ingredients just a little bit to try and get you to eat even more. The baker's goal is for you to eat nothing other than cake. Cake must consume your every waking moments, and it must haunt your dreams at night. Cake, 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 cake! So, what kind of cakes is this bakery making? Literally, almost any kind of cake you could possibly imagine. But you need to know what to ask for. If you like angel food cake and chocolate cake and ice cream cake, you will only ever be served angel food cake and chocolate cake and ice cream cake. They don't want to risk asking you to try apple spice cake because of that one time that you said you don't like carrot cake. See, the algorithm is actually kind of stupid. See, it doesn't know if you didn't like the carrot cake because of the cream cheese frosting, or because of the nutmeg in it, or maybe you were just weirded out by the idea of carrots in cake.
Well, it occurs to me that as the good algorithm gives, good algorithm can take right away again. You know, creators can find themselves really boxed in by their analytics, feeling like they need to make something that's going to do well as opposed to something that feeds their soul. Now, if you look at old YouTube, you can see there's people creating out of desire. But, you know, people gravitate to that kind of passion. And it wasn't long before they were getting 100 million views in a day. And they were acquired by the illegitimate granddaddy of internet algorithms. You know who I mean. The Google. See now, it's a little bit like noodling for catfish. Now there is definitely a chance of benefit there. So long as you don't mind risking looking like an idiot and possibly getting your arm ripped off by a crocodile. But because YouTube exists to make money, they're not going to challenge you. They're not going to try to expand your horizons because there's too high of a risk that you might click off. So instead, they show you more of the same and more of what similar people might be watching. until you think the entire internet is just a sea of cat pictures and late night TV hosts. Or worse, you watch a video about self-confidence and then 5 videos later, you're getting recommended alt-right genocide videos. Things aren't like they were before in the days of Weeble. The only option for both viewers and creators is to try to game the algorithm or exploit its weaknesses, the way the cops play copyrighted music during arrests to try and get the algorithm to delete disparaging videos. A viewer now has to try to game the algorithm to get a well-rounded homepage, and even that rarely works. Now, there's a few things you can do. You can try to look up things that you've never heard of before, or you can resist the urge to click that viral video that you have already seen 3 times before, Glenda. Of course, don't mind me. I haven't used a computer since Microsoft 8 got rid of Minesweeper. But you know, I don't miss it at all. Not even a little bit.
Now this sucks for viewers and creators. For creators, the fear of getting canceled is just weaponized embarrassment. People are so worried about being socially acceptable that we end up with Black Mirror episodes that are dedicated to the idea of being ratioed. Now I think we're all a little too obsessed with the idea of being embarrassed. Now, this is not to downplay some of the truly hateful messages that some creators have gotten after doing something that some other person perceives as an infraction. But even being gently corrected, it can feel so overwhelming at the time that it's difficult to remember that being embarrassed is literally the best case scenario to screwing up. And that's when people double down on their bad take and make things worse. It's easier said than done to just walk away from social media for a bit. So to avoid it, creators do what's proven to work instead of taking risks. And it sucks for the other side too, because as a viewer, I'd love to see more weird stuff. I want to be Alice down the rabbit hole, curiouser and curiouser. And I want the algorithm to anticipate my needs the way it claims to. I always laugh when people say that their phones are listening to them, because I'll be standing around audibly talking about Tom Selleck and Tom Selleck movies. But then when I open up my phone and I search movies with Tom, it doesn't know what frickin' Tom I mean. Here's another example. I was getting Facebook ads for this love book. I remember seeing it thinking, cute, and scrolling on. Then several weeks later, I get one as a gift. Then I start noticing more of the ads. The ads existed before I had any kind of conversation about the product. I merely didn't register them as significant in any way. It's like after you buy a Kia, you're going to see Kias everywhere. Spoiler alert, they were there before, you just had no reason to notice them. My partner and I saw the same ad campaign because the company decided to run a broad sweeping ad campaign around that time. And obviously it worked. See, your phone doesn't need to listen to you because if you hover over anything for even a millisecond, it registers that. It doesn't need to listen to you. It already knows everything about you. Going back to YouTubers, I watch a lot of them. I mean, a lot. Here's all the channels that I could think of that I am fairly familiar with over the past couple years. Some of them I'm not really a fan of now for various reasons, and some of them I was never a fan of, but either I followed them for a while or vicariously through other YouTubers to get enough of a gist of what their content is like. And more importantly, for this video, their career arc. In addition to that, if we include all of the channels that I'm peripherally aware of because of my immediate family watching YouTube, then the list looks more like... But we're gonna eliminate them since I don't force my family members to critically watch YouTube. Lockdown has been hard enough, y'all. And some of these channels have been blocked because of unethical marketing to children and child labor, but that's a story for another day. Let's also remove any that are more like corporate entities because they have enough staff that you can't really classify them as YouTubers. They're more like YouTube personalities with a staff. Because I've been watching so many YouTubers for so long, I think that we, the audience, can fairly accurately predict what a YouTuber's behavior will be based on their subscriber count. If you're at this level, it's probably primarily friends and family watching your channel, and maybe it's even private. So let's stay out of your business. Now, you're starting to get more strangers subscribing to your channel than friends and family. Now this feels weird, but also kind of validating. Like, people actually care what you have to say. This is more people than most of us have ever spoken to at one time in real life. Maybe this YouTuber is starting to play with their thumbnails, description, things like that. Let's call this stage the nano-influencer. They generally have a tight-knit following, and people are starting to watch their channel for more than just the information they post. These YouTubers don't want to disappoint their community, so they're going to try to post really regularly. And they start to feel some external pressure from other people, even if it's just in a really friendly, like, oh hey, I can't wait for your next video kind of comment. So by now, this person has probably set up a Patreon, or they've got numerous suggestions to do so. They also probably have dedicated haters. So maybe this is the point where they come across a blog or a forum that's devoted a shocking amount of time to listing all of their perceived flaws and transgressions. That's cool. This is the tier of the, I'm not a big YouTuber.
But you are, Blanche, you are!
These creators are notorious for saying that they're not one of the big fish. And no, they're not the biggest. But by now, if they're posting consistently, they're likely getting ad revenue and sponsorship offers. Considering that only 3% of channels have at least 10,000 subscribers, I would say they're a lot bigger than they think they are. More on this in a minute. This also means that they've effectively become employees. No, wait, contractors of YouTube. This means that they are beholden to the platform for at least a portion of their income. These fishies are usually willing to recognize that they have achieved conventional success by YouTube standards, but they'll also probably try to tamp it down a bit by saying that, well, they're comfortable, they're not one of the big, big YouTubers. These YouTubers are like the middle class of the developed world. They have struggles, absolutely, don't want to minimize that, but they are also in the top 2% globally. They're usually doing pretty okay in life. Or they're suffering from crippling burnout, from grinding in a corporate day in and day out, struggling with feelings of inadequacy because they aren't keeping up with the Joneses, or berating themselves because they should be more grateful for what they have. I mean, it's really a toss-up. And if this is you, then your channel might be hitting critical mass depending on your niche. This means the channel just kind of grow on its own based on the sheer number of views each video gets. Depending on where your mindset is, this is either super validating to see your hard work pay off, or it is absolutely a crushing amount of pressure. This is where a channel starts to lose me. It's almost impossible for a channel built on a single or a few personalities to be able to pump out consistent, quality, interesting, ethical content. And the success maybe changes them, or it allows their true personality to come out, either through arrogance or archaeology. Any individual with more subscribers than this is pretty much off my radar. Pretty much. There's a couple of y'all. This is where many influencers aspire to be, and I think that's why many creators are so quick to point out that they're not big YouTube channels. At this point, you barely need to do anything to maintain your channel, and pretty much any video you slap up is gonna hit the trending page. Congratulations, you won YouTube. I know I sound sour. I'm just not a fan of celebrities celebrating their own celebrity, and it almost inevitably turns into that. Maybe it's an age thing, but a 3,000 square foot closet tour that isn't narrated by Robin Leach? I mean, get out of here with your Jeffree Square.
Elegant and airy, lavishly appointed amenities include such one-of-a-kind indulgences as Eloise's boudoir, with a sunken tub overlooking the ocean. The master bedroom is a real showstopper, complete with a custom-designed canopy bed.
Trust me, I love opulence. I just think that it should be accessible to everybody. My mother always said, money can't buy you class.
You need money. All I need are some tasty waves, cool buzz, and I'm fine.
There is one crucial distinction that I would like to make. What is the difference between a creator and an influencer? Now, I would argue that a creator intends to create, and an influencer intends to influence. So, a makeup artist could be a creator, and a brooding vlogger could be an influencer, and vice versa. Spoiler alert, this usually just translates to my own perception of their actions. And that's going to be based on my own politics, identity, upbringing, and other biases. And so if you consider creators and influencers to be different people, you're subject to the same biases, most likely. This isn't to say that I hate influencers and love creators, but I do tend to prefer people that I consider to be creators. When a creator starts accepting sketchy sponsorships, or they make spurious connections and then try and like hawk products, then I tend to shift them from the creator category into the influencer category. And they, start to drop off my radar.
I would like to posit that one of the things that makes YouTubers think that they're not successful is they perhaps compare themselves to mainstream celebrities. Comparing yourselves to others can be devastating. There's this popular but improbable story that when Brian Wilson heard the Revolver album, he had a breakdown because he was working on Good Vibrations and he was supposedly devastated that they got there first. And in the same way that this metaphysical Brian Wilson should have cut himself some slack, so too should YouTubers, because they've achieved success in their own ecosystem. It's just that the ecosystem that they operate in doesn't really value creativity and sees them as disposable. Let's look at the math. Although celebrities today can be famous for a variety of things, let's take the classic fantasy profession of being an actor. It's the most analogous profession I can find data for, given that it appeals to and employs people of various ethnicities, ages, genders, and orientations. So a quick Google search says that there's approximately 19,700 actors in the US. I'm gonna limit it to the US because I'm most familiar with English language media. I'm in no way qualified to try and dig into Bollywood, let alone the whole rest of the globe. Now, let's compare an A-list celebrity versus an A-list YouTuber, and a B-lister and a D-lister. Now, I'll admit, it was pretty hard to even find actors who have YouTube channels, so I'm not saying that these people are in any way equivalent when it comes to talent or genre or anything else. I'm just trying to stick with the definitions of what an A-lister and a B-lister, etc., actually are. Let's look at their reported net worth and income. Now, let's take a look at the same people's YouTube followings and their Social Blade profiles. As you can see, the professional YouTuber has a way higher number of subscribers than the professional actor. And yet the actor is blowing it out of the water when it comes to income and net worth. The reality is, only a tiny fraction of those 19,000 actors experience real notoriety. But the ecosystem that they're swimming in is much smaller and pays higher dividends. Whereas every day, countless channels are hitting monetization numbers, but the ecosystem is so vast that the payoff just can't be equivalent. That being said, they are making pretty serious scratch compared to the average person. Levi Hildebrand made $100,000 in 2020. Who's Levi Hildebrand? I don't even know. That's how ridiculously big the YouTube ecosystem is.
Does Dunbar's number translate to parasocial relationships?
Interesting question.
I would argue that it does, because most of you we humans know more about our favorite YouTuber than we do about, say, Deb at the water cooler.
Ugh. Sorry I missed your birthday, Deb. I was, busy? I think we could see a natural cycle play out where bigger YouTubers decide to live off of their continued revenue or they move on to other projects, and then that makes way for up-and-comers. Think like, Jake Yonsei and Bussy Queen, but on a grander scale. Anyway, where was I? Oh yeah, so YouTube is trying to funnel you into watching the same kind of videos all the time, and it's trying to funnel creators into making the same kind of content all the time. Now, back to the pandemic. See, you might have thought I forgot about that, but I didn't. We can never forget about it, because always keeps coming back.
Now, the pandemic provided a huge boost to a lot of channels, and it gave a huge incentive to want to work hard and try and retain that new audience. But it also came with a whole host of other issues. Namely, a deluge of other new YouTubers. Sales for Ring Light skyrocketed, and more people, faced with loads of free time to explore their hobbies and hungry for a social outlet, took to creating their own channels in the hopes of maybe escaping the rat race when this is all over. You would think all this extra content would appease the algorithm, but the algorithm is never sated. Instead of boosting new content, the same creators get promoted over and over again. So you have thousands or even millions of little minnow channels all jockeying for position. They pore over the Reddits and they try to do exactly what they think the algorithm wants. Work on your SEO, work on your thumbnails, start a new channel, find your niche, and so on and so forth.
So, did anyone else see the Spiffing Brit video? I actually stopped making shorts just after I saw that video. At that point, I already knew brevity was not my forte. But if I were to do what the algorithm wanted, this channel would look very different. And it also would have been a recipe for burnout. My most popular video, by far, is this one. At the time of filming this, it has about 8.4 thousand views, which is 8 times more than the next highest video. And it's objectively the worst video on my entire channel. Just listen to this.
Those are the shrieking eels.
And yet, here we are. The algorithm. Spoken. My analytics show that I should keep my mouth shut and cook and clean. Okay, cool.
Cool.
Except it is hard enough to get up the wherewithal to clean every day, let alone pull out a freaking camera every time. And everyone in my family has different dietary restrictions, so every food that I make gets eaten by one or two people max. I don't want to waste food for views. I'm not really into wasteful content at all, and I don't think that there's a long future for it. Just like I don't really think that there's a long future for shorts.
Hey, who likes short shorts?
Stop trying to make
shorts
happen.
For me at least, there's no evidence that short subscribers will ever end up watching your longer videos. And I'm not doing any of this to go viral. I just want to make weird stuff that I think is cool. But that being said, nobody starts posting on YouTube because they hope that they're going to be endlessly screaming into the void for eternity.
Meanwhile, King Arthur and Sir Bedivere, not more than a swallow's flight away, had discovered something.
Sometimes I think that my brain works a little bit like a broken algorithm. I think a lot of people, when they find something that reinforces their worldview, then they add it to their like memory bank, and if it doesn't reinforce their worldview, then they kind of discard it. Whereas for me, if anything challenges what I already think to be true about the world, I need to hold on to that idea. I need to examine it. I need to work on it and play with it like Play-Doh until it makes sense with all of the other information that I have in the world. And it's obsessive and over-analytical and weird, but I think that it gives me a comprehensive, if chaotic, worldview. But that being said, it is super complicated and really difficult to parse out that information and communicate it to other people.
The essence of chaos.
And I can be terrible at verbalizing it, so I guess this is kind of an exercise in that. Like if we're standing at a fork in the road and everybody is trying to decide, well, should we go left or should we go right? And my gut says we should go left. Well, the group is gonna probably decide to go right, because when they ask me, well, why should we go left? All I can say is, well, I feel like it. Don't say you feel like anything is true. You're never gonna win an argument that way. But then when we go down the right path, that's when I start remembering, oh, right, I saw the topographical map that it is actually a lower elevation here. Oh, right. And I remember that I saw on the weather 2 months ago that it was really rainy in the spring in this area. Oh, right. And I remember that there's venomous snakes that are endemic to this area that like to live in swampy areas. We should not be here. It's really hard for me to verbalize because when somebody says something like, hey, what do you want to eat? My brain does this.
Oh, man, you know what I love? Strawberries. And that always makes me think about that scene in Soylent Green where he's like, strawberries? Where did you get strawberries? Because they're so, like, opulent. You earn everything. Like, a strawberry lemonade would be so nice. But then lemonade makes me think about Beyonce. And then I think, you know, it's crazy how it doesn't matter what your political affiliation is or anything else. If there's any correlation between success and infidelity, it's not a good one. And then that makes me think about, like, career couples, like Will Smith and Jada, you know, where their identity is very much centered around being, like, a united couple, and they won't let anything get in the way of that. And then that makes me think, you know, it's kind of a callback to the 1950s WASP culture and how you had no idea what was going on behind closed doors in those families. And then that makes me think, like, can you predict if a couple is gonna split up? Like, did anybody see that going as much off the rails as it did? And then that makes me think about, just in general, the whole idea of reinventing yourself and how easy it is for the rich to just snap their fingers and become a different person. And then that makes me wonder, what does a publicist make? And then I think about the wild economy that surrounds rich people. There are jobs that wouldn't even exist in a regular person's life. And in that same vein, you know, that makes me think about the actual labor that makes the world run, that is all done by regular people. And then I think, squirrel! Oh, love squirrels so much. They're beautiful and inquisitive and curious. They look like little superheroes. And then that makes me think about, like, labor in the animal kingdom in general, like little beavers doing their thing. And then I think about dung beetles. And then I think how they remind me of Sisyphus rolling that rock up the hill. And that makes me think about Albert Camus, which makes me think about The Outsider, which makes me think about death. And then I think about life support and the right to die, parents keeping their kids on life support. And then I wonder about, you know, the morals and ethics around that. And I think about the ensuing court battles. And that makes me think about night court. And then I wonder, what are they up to now? And it's interesting because I know that these guys ended up doing some stuff, but the only one that I'd be able to Google by name is John Larroquette. And isn't that so interesting how in a group there's always kind of one person that ends up becoming more notable than the rest? It's gonna be May. How many days is it actually gonna be until May? It's the final countdown. Actually, is that an interesting number? Oh, that makes me think about the interesting number paradox. That makes me think about taxicab numbers. You know what's weird is, like, taxis and Uber and, like, the gig economy in general. You know what's actually wild is that you could get a strawberry that was grown thousands of miles away, delivered to your house in the middle of winter. Like, that's not sustainable, man.
Meanwhile, you've been waiting for an answer for at least the last
41 seconds, according to his unfailing internal clock.
And you think I'm ignoring you. I'm not. My Mothra used to say that sometimes talking to me was a little bit like being inside a blender. And now that I'm a parent to offspring that share a lot of my traits, I understand what she meant. Now, I can't know for sure, but I have a theory about why my brain does that, or why it's able to do that, I guess. So I was always under the impression that when you see a movie or a TV show and you can hear a character's thoughts in a voiceover, like Carrie Bradshaw, The Wonder Years comes to mind, but there's so many examples. I just assumed that we accepted that the same way when you go into a monster movie, you just accept that vampires exist. Which they definitely don't, and I'm definitely not one, obviously. So when I found out that other people had this internal monologue, I was kind of othered in my own mind. And then I found out that there's the ability to see pictures in your mind, and not being able to see pictures and not being able to hear words are not related. They're independent of each other, but I can't do either of them. So I think that because my brain is not being used up with all of these words and pictures, it frees it up to make connections. And so that's what my brain does. And I mean, it does it pretty quick. Like, I'm not saying that to brag, because it actually can be pretty debilitating sometimes.
Check it out! Major input! Reverend, wait here. I'll be right back after these words. Input, input, input! Woo! Woo!
Input! So back to the old broken algorithm. Because I'm constantly reassessing my worldviews and adding new pieces of information all the time, this can look a lot like indecision. And that's especially true if I'm just starting to learn about a new topic. I remember getting in trouble in class sometimes because I didn't want to voice an opinion. I found it a lot easier and a lot more compelling to play devil's advocate to other people and point out the flaws in their arguments or find connections that other people hadn't noticed before, rather than trying to verbalize what this massive web of connections boils down to. And frankly, I'm not super motivated to do it. So that's what this can be. I will do my word vomit, and if anybody else out there in the world wants to try and boil it down into like a consommé of thought, good on ya. I sure as heck can't.
To make the demi-glace, it needs the flesh and bones of 40 cows. 40, monsieur. Simmering, stir, cook, and cook down until there is nothing at the end. Nothing. Just a teacup, a thimbleful of beef's most precious essence.
This far, it may come as no surprise that I think I might have ADHD. Like, I don't know if you can diagnose it with memes, but I'm feeling very attacked. So anyway, I mean, while this may not be any great revelation to you, to me it was kind of wild, because I've always had this kind of Freudian view that like everybody else's brain kind of worked the same as mine. I call it Freudian because he just assumed that everybody else shared his sexual proclivities. In my defense, this isn't something that you can know unless it's pointed out to you. I mean the different thought processes, not the sex stuff.
But you agree about the sex stuff. Yeah.
Ew.
Just threw up in my mouth a little bit.
My partner never knew he needed glasses until I pointed out that his eyesight was poorer than average. He doesn't know what average eyesight looks like, and I didn't know how an average brain worked. I kind of figured everybody was making these connections all the time. Maybe not the exact same connections, but, you know, a similar corkboard. I realize now that that potentially or probably isn't the case. All of this is just to say that it makes staying on topic long enough to do like a granular deep dive, difficult. But also, I just have like such a myriad of interests that there's not really any other way to contain them all. I don't want to try to become a cooking channel or a sewing channel, and I'm certainly not qualified to be a philosophy channel. Although I do appreciate the aesthetic. No. There are plenty of people out there that are already doing it much better. And I can't even find my cat ears. I just don't have the passion and focus to make it happen. What I'm passionate about is making connections. So instead of a deep dive, I propose a frolic through the field of knowledge. I can't really narrow things down more than that. I'm sorry, I'm not like other girls.
But you are, Blanche, you are!
I definitely had my own Brian Wilson moment when I saw the trailer for Natalie's newest video. But the beauty of what I'm trying to create is that I don't envy her envy video. I know, ironic. It's like red. I didn't even need to see the video to know that it would be fundamentally different from mine, even if there are similarities. Because a million monkeys on a million typewriters may be able to reproduce the works of Shakespeare. But more likely, you're gonna get a million different variations that are actually more interesting.
My favorite movie is Love Don't Cost a Thing with Nick Cannon, which is based on Can't Buy Me Love, which is based on Kramer vs. Kramer or something, which I think was Shakespeare. Don't know, don't care.
As an INTP Taurus, I can definitely say, I've never been one for labels.
Nobody puts baby in a corner.
I went to a publicly funded high school that was for the arts. I had been the kind of kid that everybody just assumed would go there because I was a little weird. The wild thing is, I went to this school thinking I would finally find people similar to me, and if anything, I found that environment even more limiting. It wasn't enough to just be different anymore. You were supposed to find the group of different people that you were most similar to and assimilate in with them. The art kids don't hang out with the drama kids, who don't hang out with the jocks, who certainly don't hang out with the music kids. And, I mean, I'd heard about this cliche being prevalent in schools in the Midwest, but I had never experienced anything quite like it before, and certainly since. I don't mind being unique. But sometimes it's a little tiring. I remember this one outfit I loved wearing. It was this pink pirate shirt with huge ruffles along the neck and the sleeves. And the ruffles had wire sewn into the ends, so you could style it really dramatically. And I'd wear it with this long lilac polyester vest, like the kind Carol Brady might wear. And then I'd wear them with these purple and pink pinstriped circus pants that had a wide cuff. And to top off this glorious look, all black makeup. I vividly recall walking down the hallway one day, and a group of goths saw my makeup and scoffed at me and asked, "Are you trying to be a goth?" I looked down at my clown outfit, and I didn't even know how to respond. I only lasted at that school for about a year, and then I went to a quote-unquote normal school. And nobody thought my feather boas and wigs were any weirder than the pantsuit that I wore to my grad, because it was all equally weird to them. I don't think I'm some special misunderstood flower. I'm just saying, I think that algorithms are originally designed by people, and people are used to sorting each other into neat little boxes, even if that means filing them down a bit in our minds. Well, I refuse to be filed.
I reject your reality and substitute my own.
I'm certainly not the first to talk about YouTube burnout, but I did want to try to bring together some of what they're saying and show how it connects to other things. I used to work in retail, and selling shit sucks. Selling yourself is even worse. Like, even if I really believe in the product, I'm not capitalist enough to engage with the system without a low-level feeling of nausea.
I don't want to sell anything, buy anything, or process anything as a career. I don't want to sell anything bought or processed, or buy anything sold or processed, or process anything sold, bought, or processed, or care anything sold, bought, or processed. You know, it's a career. I don't want to do that.
This is probably exacerbated by the fact that I personally have never made enough money to ethically outsource labor. Let's just say there's a reason I learned how to sew and cook and not play an instrument. So, why now? Why like this? Why am I putting so much effort into this dumb little video when I know I'm doing everything wrong? Well, maybe it's dumb, but I think the pond is finally ready for this fish. See, I've been around for a while. I'm old enough to remember how the Steve Wilkos show started.
Real talk, straight from the heart. Jerry Springer, the right talk, right now.
I remember airline peanuts.
Peanuts? Oh, sure, thank you very much. I thought you were talking about something else.
I'm old enough, I used to buy Wonder Bras from Zellers. I remember Liv Tyler long before she learned Elvish. Gee willikers, I'm so old, I know who all these guys are.
Cheese dogs.
Back in my day.
And I had the extreme privilege of generational knowledge from a loving, if bizarre, home. My mother was a sharp lady. We were early technology adopters in our house, but we also heeded early warnings. And instilled in me from a young age was the knowledge that anything I put on the internet is there forever.
Forever. Forever. Forever.
She's a big history buff, so she knew that the most powerful people can get taken down because they were careless.
And flashlights, they're keeping me awake. Okay, sir, I'll check it out. Thank you.
No problem.
Good night. Good night.
That makes her sound like some kind of Machiavellian evil genius. No comment. So I was never anxious to put myself out there on the internet, just cautious. I mean, I met my partner online, but on our first date, we met in a public place, and I texted his driver's license number to, you guessed it, Mothra.
All I could think of the minute you left was, I want my mommy.
This was before the days of smartphones, kids. Hard times. But now that I no longer have a need to find a partner or get interviewed for a high-stakes job, I feel more comfortable allowing my visage to grace the internet. Let's also not forget the benefit of existing pre-internet. It means I was old enough that once the internet became something you could carry around in your pocket, I was already old enough to know how cringe some of the humor was. And being a nerd, I had already seen most of what was on the internet as we think of it now, from the start. I remember Hamster Dance, which at the time, no one believed me that it was the Disney Robin Hood music, but it is. But that also means that I remember things like Jenna Marbles' early videos. Now, I'm not gonna weigh in on what kind of a person she is now. It sounds like she's become a kind and empathetic person. But I couldn't get into her when everybody else was, because I remembered the kinds of videos that made her go viral in the first place. And again, loads of privilege recognized. Some people aren't lucky enough to be informed and able to consciously decide what they get to share with the world without having to worry about the consequences. If Maslow's hierarchy is valid, and there's some debate about that, but anyway, using Maslow's hierarchy as a framework, I already have all these other levels pretty well taken care of. I may seem like a dissatisfied person in real life, because I'm more likely to voice displeasure.
They've put grapes in a cheese sandwich.
But overall, I'm actually pretty content. Heck, I'm even pretty happy.
but you keep it all inside.
You can really taste the grassy notes of suburbia. When I became a stay-at-home mom, it took a really long time before I felt like I had enough time and energy to dedicate to a YouTube channel. But I've thought about it for a long time. And you can see from my posting history, there were a few false starts. In my defense, part-time YouTubers typically choose to make their videos about their real-life careers or about their hobbies. When you're a stay-at-home parent, that means mommy blogging. Someday maybe I'll make a whole video about it, but long story short, using your children to make content is questionable. And even if it wasn't, it doesn't really fit with my vibe. I love my kids. Like, I live for my kids. But being a parent isn't really my identity. It's just a biological function that has occurred.
Look at this place. Look, this is an emergency, darling. Look at this, look. La croix, baby spew.
So again, I waited to share this with the world. But in all this time, I've been like the algorithm, shifting and changing aspects of myself so that the coalescence you see before you matches how I feel on the inside, and making myself into my own favorite kind of cake. This metaphor has gotten away from me now, but, and the fact that you're watching this now, it means I did it. I finished it. I finished the video. And this is probably the most ambitious thing that I've ever completed in my life. And I don't even know how that's gonna feel, but it seems like it's gonna feel great. To me, it means that I'm here, I'm ready, I'm creating, I'm doing the things that I've wanted to do for so long. I'm even aiming to make the next video in less time than it took to make this one.
I think it's terribly dangerous for an artist to fulfill other people's expectations. I think they generally produce their worst work when they do that. And if the other thing I would say is that if you feel safe in the area that you're working in, you're not working in the right area. Always go a little further into the water than you feel you're capable of being in. Go a little bit out of your depth. And when you don't feel that your feet are quite touching the bottom, you're just about in the right place to do something exciting.
But I refuse to fall victim to burnout. I'm going to take the advice of Kimberly, of Adam, of Taika, and I'm going to do what feeds my creativity.
I want to make art, arty. And I want to make trouble. You in?
If you're into that, welcome, fellow Earth human. And if you're not, well...
I didn't make him for you!
What? Fuck. Was that? Is that it? No. What the fuck was that?
Maybe she just ran out of time.
She went on for over an hour. I'm calling my agent.
What does this mean?
But how could you possibly make a video about algorithms without even mentioning HFT algorithms? Or
what the hell, Garrett?
Yeah, of course I'm upset.
Grocery logistics.
Huh?
Real estate.
Oh, she went up by $100.
You know what I can teach you?
The TikTok.
I don't need any
AI learning.
Capture.
I don't understand. Is she not doing stop motion anymore?
Yeah, well, look into it. My contract clearly states
it's marketing.
You call yourself a
She didn't even cover anything.
She cannot imagine.
Why?
Certainly can't call yourself an expert in anything. What do you think, Bjorn?
I have a nut.
Oh, Bjorn.
PA algorithm. Dolna e i threglie.